Hello, my name is James Kubli. I'm an applications engineer here at Saratech, and in this video we're going to be talking about how to set up hydrostatic loads in your model using data surfaces. What I have here is a simple cylinder shape. You can consider it more like a graduated cylinder. It is approximately 10 units in diameter and about 100 units tall. I'm going to assume inches right now with my material and my loading conditions. So if we take a look at here, we could take a look at our constraints. You can see I mostly have it constrained in the Z direction with some occasional little nodal constraints over here in the X and Y, just to make sure this thing is free to expand on the bottom without creating any sort of unnecessary stresses there. So before you do this, you're going to want to calculate your hydrostatic pressures at the different depths. I'm going to be approximating stuff off of memory from the calculations I did before, so they're not going to be 100% accurate, so please don't double check me on those values here. So first things first, we can go into data surfaces here, and we're going to want to create a new data surface. I find the between coordinates data surface is probably the best one to use. And we're going to give this a name here, call it hydrostatic. Mouse there. And so basically all we need is 2-point linear. Hydrostatic forces are linear increasing. So we just need to pick a point to start with and a point to end at. As you can see right here, the very top of my graduated cylinder, there is the origin right there. So we've got our 000 right there. As you can see, it just put this information in there because I clicked on it. Let's go ahead and remove that. So, but I don't technically want my model this or my hydrostatic forces to start at zero. I'm going to say this thing's only partially filled. So I'm going to end up offsetting this a bit. Remember, this is in the positive Z direction. So I'm just going to offset this a bit by what I'm going to consider 25 inches. So we should be starting, our hydrostatic forces should start about 25 inches from the top and continue on down for 75 inches. So this is definitely a very tall graduated cylinder. And then we'll go here, direction. I can click on here. For example, I can have it snap to a node or a point, for example. But if I do get things a little crooked here, the vector it's going to create is going to have my hydrostatic forces at a pressure. So if I misclicked here, let's say I clicked here, and instead of coming straight down, I accidentally clicked over a node, it's going to create, from those two points, it's going to create the vector of the depth, and it's going to have my fluid at an awkward angle here at the top. Now, maybe that might be correct for you, or maybe your model doesn't particularly, or your hydrostatic forces don't align appropriately with, or align directly with the global coordinate system, but in this particular situation, it's pretty straightforward for me. Now, I'm going to put a little past 100 here. I'm going to go with 125, just simply so I don't have any sort of round-off issues here on the bottom, and I've overshot it. And again, if I'm going off of memory here, so I don't know if this is necessarily correct, but I believe it's around 2.7 PSI at 125 inches. Again, off of memory, not necessarily accurate, but I do highly recommend doing the math beforehand, so that way you don't have to necessarily do it. But you can always go back and modify this once you've set up your hydrostatic forces. Or your data surface there. So again, we can always come back in here and edit this and change this value if we like. Let's go ahead and apply our load. Call that hydro for short. And we're gonna apply this on surfaces. I'm not gonna select everything because if I do that, I'm gonna end up with the solid geometry. I actually created a solid cylinder for this and just selected three of the faces for my cylinder there. I'm going to click OK, and what we're going to do is just going to end up a pressure. We'll do a unit load of one. You could technically put your final pressure value here as long as you're like your hydrostatic scale is from like 0 to 1. I find that a bit more complicated with the math, so I like to just put my pressure values at that exact depth into my data surface instead. So now that we've got our pressure value 1, normal to element face is fine. We're going to go over here and change this to data surface. And from here, we could select this drop down now. We could have always gone here and clicked this to create a new data surface, but creating it in advance is a bit easier. I'm not going to really give it a name. It's not that important right now. One more click OK here. And let's take a look. Let's turn on my loads here. And we could see all my loads are inward. So technically, this would be like I've inserted it into the water, 75 inches. So let's just go back here, edit my load, and just change this to a negative value. Otherwise, the other option would be just to change the element normal and have that would reverse the direction of the pressure values. Now you can see it's only showing the magnitude on the entire model. Can't really tell if it's calculating everything properly. It's showing it everywhere. So the best way to verify that you've actually set up any sort of pressure like this, any sort of variable load, is to go to model output from load here. It's going to give it a name. It's going to need that new output set. So I'm going to call this hydro pressure verification and click OK. Here, we're going to select elemental loads pressures and go OK. You can see down here in the message window, it created a new output vector. We can look over here in our results and there we go. Just double click on it, make sure it's active. It was active anyways, but anyways, I always do that just to be safe. That error message, don't worry about it. It's just defaulting to what it thinks the output vector you want. So we'll just go over here, select the actual output vector, which is our pressure. And there we go. Now we've got verification of our actual pressure distribution. So you can see here, it's starting off near the top. It's not going to be exactly zero because technically 25 inches is somewhere right here in between these two elements, or right in the middle of this element here. So it's only going to capture elements partially. So we're getting this 0.54 load there, and that goes all the way down to the 2.025 that it should be calculating right here. Remember that 2.7 that I put in was further below beneath this. This was just to make sure the bottom was fully enclosed, or the everything was fully loaded. Now, there is a weird thing I've noticed here. It might be an issue with 2406 and how it's visualizing. But you can see here, there's kind of this curvature here to this pressure. You'd expect more perfectly horizontal bands. I played around with the display settings and I can't quite figure out what's going on. But no matter how I rotate the model, it's always got that distribution display there. So I think it's just color gradient shading that's going on through the angle. Because you can see over here, we've got full white here, but we get some shading the gray as the model rotates around. So you can probably dig into the display settings. You might be able to fix it, but don't be too concerned about this curvature here that you might see. And that's just due to the shading of the curvature of the model here. Again, most importantly, just verify that your peak values here, like this max pressure down here at the bottom, is correct, and your the location of your zero pressure is appropriate. And from that, you should have hydrostatic forces applied to your model. Thank you.